Heavenly Father, thank you that you are a faithful God and you never let go of us. You are always with us through every trial, every difficulty and every storm. We pray again, may the Christians in India know this truth, that you are with them in this moment and this crisis. And I thank you that you are with us now as we read from your holy word. I pray you would speak. May my words honour and glorify you, Lord God. I pray you would be lifted high. I pray truth would be proclaimed and you would help us understand and apply this word to our lives. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So today we're continuing our sermon series through the Gospel of Matthew. We've got to chapter 14 and we've been in this book for a while. And this morning, we're going to read a story of marriage gone wrong, a story about murder, featuring three big New Testament characters, featuring John the Baptist, featuring Herod, King Herod, and featuring Jesus himself. It sounds a bit like a soap opera, doesn't it? Marriage gone wrong, murder, big characters. If it were a soap opera, this episode would be entitled Herod's Most Significant Sin. That's what my sermon's called this morning. Herod's Most Significant Sin. And we're going to begin by reading the Bible together. So I'm going to read Matthew chapter 14, verses 1 to 12. If you've got a Bible at home, please do open it and read along. If not, the words will appear on the screen as I read. Matthew 14, verses 1 to 12. At that time, Herod the Tetrarch heard about the fame of Jesus. And he said to his servants, "This is John the Baptist. He has been raised from the dead. That is why these miraculous powers are at work in him." For Herod had seized John and bound him and put him in prison for the sake of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, because John had been saying to him, "It is not lawful for you to have her." And though he wanted to put him to death, he feared the people, because they held him to be a prophet. But when Herod's birthday came, the daughter of Herodias danced before the company and pleased Herod, so that he promised with an oath to give her whatever she might ask. Prompted by her mother, she said, "Give me the head of John the Baptist here on a platter." And the king was sorry, but because of his oaths and his guests, he commanded it to be given. He sent and had John beheaded in prison, and his head was brought on a platter and given to the girl, and she brought it to her mother. And his disciples came and took the body and buried it, and they went and told Jesus. Let's unpack that fairly brutal, horrific story together. The story begins with an unlawful marriage, looking at verses 3 and 4. King Herod was the ruler of Galilee, and he had a half-brother called Philip. Confusingly, his brother Philip is often called Herod Philip. So Herod has a brother called Herod Philip, or Herod has a brother called Philip, as it says in the Bible. And Philip had a wife called Herodias, again similar to the name Herod. So Philip and Herodias are married, and King Herod, the ruler of Galilee, also has a wife as well. But the story goes like this. Philip went away on a business trip to Rome, and while he was away, King Herod of Galilee went and slept with his brother's wife, Herodias. Herod got divorced from his wife, and Herodias filed for divorce from Philip. And so Herod and Herodias then got married. We don't know whether the marriage was for genuine love or whether it was a power play from King Herod seeking to undermine his brother, perhaps even claim his brother's territory. But whatever, whether it's for love or for power, it's a fairly horrendous episode in history. King Herod has betrayed his brother, slept with his brother's wife, and then got his wife to divorce him, and then married her himself. Herod has got a divorce himself on unlawful grounds. He has no reason to divorce his wife, and yet that's what he's done. And he's forced Herodias to unlawfully divorce Philip. It's a huge mess and a terrible story. That's where this story begins, with sin within marriage, relationships, and sex. And so I think it's important at this point to make a point about that. This is my first point, really, this morning. It's a point about marriage, divorce, adultery, and romantic relationships. Sexual sin in Matthew 14 ultimately led to the murder of John the Baptist. And so you can see in this sequence of events just how powerful relationships and sex and marriage can really be. This is an area that influences every other area of your life. And so if there's sin in this area, then it can have a significant impact on you. I would say that sex, marriage, relationships, romantic relationships is a key area where Christians either show their faith and make godly decisions, not like Herod in this story, or they fall to temptation and have a significant impact on not only their life, but also the lives of others. And so I want to make three statements about marriage, adultery, divorce, and romantic relationships. I want to make three statements to help us as a church and as Christians live out God's vision for marriage and for love. And so the first statement is this: we pray for strong marriages, for happy marriages, and marriages that are full of love. That's what we want in Christ Church Fareham: strong, happy, love-filled marriages. Not like the marriages represented in this story, not like King Herod's marriage to his first wife, and not like Philip's marriage to Herodias. In the Bible, husbands are called to love their wives as Christ loved the church and loves the church. And now we know that Jesus Christ laid down his life for the church. He died on the cross so that all who put their faith in him can be forgiven their sin and be freed into eternal life. That's the love displayed by Jesus Christ. He loves the church so much, he died for her. And so the love that is called for in marriage is a love that denies ourselves in order to love the other. Jesus made sacrifices to love the church, and so husbands are called to make sacrifices to love their wives. So the love of marriage is a self-denying, sacrificial love. Christ's love for the church is also eternal. He has always loved the church. It says in the Bible that God chose us before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. Jesus enacted the plan, displaying his love on the cross, but it wasn't just a one-time act of love. It's a love that's gone right from the beginning of time all the way to the end of time. Throughout history, Christ has loved the church. And so Christ's love is a faithful love, an eternal love. And so the love between a husband and a wife not only should be sacrificial and self-denying, it should also be faithful. That's why the Bible teaches that the only place where sex should happen is within marriage. Sex is the culmination and consummation of an amazing love story where two people say to one another, "I love you with a faithful love. I'm going to love you for the rest of my life until death do us part. And I'm also going to love you with a Christ-like, sacrificial, self-denying love. I'm going to put your interests first. I'm going to put you first in terms of the way I live my life." And so you have this faithful, sacrificial love that is expressed in what sex really is. Sex is more meaningful within a married relationship because it is this moment of saying, "My love for you is faithful. My love for you is self-denying and not self-interested. interested, and therefore I give you everything that I am. That's why it was God's good, wise, and loving plan and instruction to people to only have sex within marriage, where it really does mean this faithfulness and this self-denying love that is expressed in marriage in the Bible. But to love someone like this is not easy. Christ's love for the church was not easy. It required sacrifice. It required strength of character. And in the same way, marriage is a wonderful gift, an amazing, amazing gift, but it's also hard. It's hard to love someone with a faithful love. It's hard to love someone with a self-denying love, always looking to their interests above your own. And so that's why we need to pray for strong marriages, marriages that really do reflect the love of Christ for the church. If you're married, can I encourage you to pray for your marriage? Pray for a strong marriage. And can I encourage you to prioritize your marriage? After God, your most important relationship is with your spouse. That's a biblical, godly thing to prioritize. So pray for your marriage, prioritize your marriage. And whether you're married or single, can I encourage you to pray for the marriages in Christchurch Fareham? Pray that the marriages would be strong and happy and filled with love. Because although marriage is a wonderful gift, it's also hard. And we want strong marriages in our church. Not like this story. This story ends in murder, but it begins with unhappy marriages. And so that's why we need to pray for strong marriages within Christchurch Fareham. So that's our first statement. We pray for strong marriages. Our second statement on this area of sex and marriage is this. We hate adultery and divorce. These are the sins on full show in the Herod and Herodias story. They commit adultery, they cheat on their spouses, and then they end up getting divorces in order to marry each other. If marriage is meant to show the faithful love of Christ, then to commit adultery, to cheat, or to sleep with someone outside of marriage is to destroy that picture of Christ's awesome, faithful love. For that reason, God calls adultery, which is all sex outside of marriage, and God calls divorce sinful. He hates divorce. He hates adultery. And so we, with God, say, yes, we see those things as sinful. We see adultery as sinful, and we see divorce as sinful. We hate those things. Now remember, the gospel, the Christian gospel, is a gospel of mercy and forgiveness. The good news of Jesus is that he died on the cross for the sins of the world so that whoever believes in him would be forgiven. So if you're thinking, oh, adultery is sinful, divorce is sinful, and I've done one of those or both of those, don't despair. Believe in Christ, receive forgiveness. But as Christians, full of the Holy Spirit, we need to recognize these things are not of God. Adultery and divorce are not of God. The only reason to have a divorce, according to Jesus in the Bible, is if your partner has been sexually unfaithful. So if your partner has not been faithful to you and has committed the sin of adultery, then you have grounds for divorce. But all other grounds are not grounds for divorce. What God has joined together, let no man separate. So we hate adultery, we hate sex outside of marriage, and we hate divorce because these things are sinful and not God's perfect plan for what marriage and love really should be. Married people, if you're struggling, then share your struggles. Speak to someone, come and speak to me. We will do everything we can as a church to help you and your marriage thrive. I promise you that. It won't be judgmental conversation. It will be, let's sit down, let's talk about this. Marriage is hard. Let's work this out. Let's make it work. We will do everything we can to help you. So don't struggle in silence, but come and share. And you know, I'm not saying that I personally will do that counseling and that help. I'll make sure that you speak to the right people so that you can get the help that you need to make your marriage thrive. Single people, if you're struggling with temptation to commit adultery. Or even if you're on the path to that, if you're watching pornography, for example, or you're looking at images and things that you shouldn't be looking at, I would also encourage you to share and confess your sin and be open about that. Again, you can come and speak to me or speak to someone else in the church. The church is a place where we share our struggles with sin. Because my third statement on marriage, sex, and romantic relationships is this. Let us seek romantic relationships in a godly way. Christian, if you're looking for a marriage partner, do not be like Herod. You know, this is the worst example you could possibly follow. Someone who goes and pursues his brother's wife, sleeps with her while she's still married, and then forces her to get a divorce so he can marry her. This is not a model. No, Christian, you have a higher calling. You are called to seek a member of the opposite sex to be married to. To find someone who's a Christian, who shares your love of Jesus, and to abstain from sexual relations until after marriage. For this is the way that our God, who is a God of love and a God of wisdom, gives to us to enter into marriage. Now, there's no denying that that journey is a hard one, full of temptations. But I want you to trust God, to believe that he is good and that what he has for you in your life is the very, very best. We do believe that, don't we? That God is good. Jesus Christ showed his goodness in dying for us. And so we believe that God is good. And so what he has for us is the very best. And if this is the way he says we should do relationships, then let's trust him with that. Let's say, God, you're a good God. You know what's best. I'm going to rely on you. And of course, people who are godly in the way they pursue romantic relationships, some of those people will go for a prolonged period or perhaps their entire lives being single. Some people choose to be single. They don't want to get married, and that's a good choice. If you're a Christian, you want to remain single, then that's great, that's fantastic. But some people, choosing to be godly in the way they pursue relationships just doesn't happen for them. And they spend a long portion of their life being single when perhaps they would rather be married. And of course, that life comes with challenges. It definitely does. The church has to do more to help people struggling with loneliness. But what a wonderful act of worship. In your singleness, to trust God and say, God is good. He really does do what's best for me. And although there's loads within me that desperately wants to be married, I'm going to continue being godly. I'm going to continue to seek a Christian husband or wife. I'm going to pray for that. I'm going to abstain from sexual relations until after marriage. I'm going to stay faithful to God because I know he's always faithful to me. What a wonderful act of worship. And I know a number of Christians who've remained single, who've done amazing things for God, partly because of their singleness. So those are my three statements. Let's pray for strong marriages. Let's hate adultery and divorce. And let us seek romantic relationships in a godly way. Because what Herod does is the exact opposite of that. And he creates a messy situation which ultimately results in a despicable act of murder. We want our relationships, our marriages, to be holy, godly, and faithful to how God instructs us to live. And so let's pray for that in Christ Church Fareham. Now let's get back to the story. So Herod and Herodias both have unlawful divorces. And then they have an unlawful marriage, and John the Baptist, as God's prophet, speaks up. He says to Herod, it is not lawful for you to have her. It's not lawful for you to marry her. You're still, in the eyes of God, married to your first wife. That divorce was an unlawful divorce. And Herodias is still married to Philip. That was an unlawful divorce as well. And your marriage is unlawful. John rightly speaks into this situation. And of course, the truth is that Christians often need to speak hard truth into the lives of others. It is right for God's appointed people to speak up into the affairs of others, into relationships and marriage even, even when they're speaking hard truths. John demonstrates this for us. He's not afraid to tell Herod and Herodias the things that they don't want to hear. It's part of his role as prophet. So John is hated by Herod, and he's hated by Herodias. Now, Herod is scared to kill John the Baptist, so he throws him in jail, but he doesn't want to have him killed because he's a prophet, and the Jewish people saw him as a prophet and might have been an uprising if John was killed. So Herod's in this place of hating John the Baptist and what he's saying about his marriage, fearful of the crowds, and so he throws John in jail until, in verse 7, he makes a very stupid promise, doesn't he? It's Herod's birthday, and he's having great celebrations, and Salome, daughter of Herodias, does a wonderful dance for Herod on his birthday. It's such a wonderful dance that Herod promises, he takes an oath to give her whatever she asks for. If Herod's first sin in this story was adultery and divorce and an unlawful marriage, his second sin is making a stupid, stupid oath. It's so stupid, isn't it? Someone does a nice dance for you and you promise to give them whatever they ask for, and you take an oath, you swear that you're going to give them whatever they ask for. It's so foolish of Herod. This is what Jesus says about oaths in Matthew 5 verse 34. Do not take an oath at all, either by heaven, for it is the throne of God, or by the earth, for it is his footstool. Let what you say simply be yes or no. Anything more than this comes from evil. So Herod demonstrates sheer stupidity in making a promise of whatever Salome asks for. Jesus says, don't take oaths at all. Simply let your yes be yes and your no be no. Don't swear by things. This comes from evil. Don't make promises you cannot keep. This comes from evil. And when you say you'll do something, do it. I think that's a really key lesson from what Jesus is saying. Let your yes be yes and let your no be no. He's saying when you say yes, do what you say you're going to do. And when you say no, don't do what you're saying you're not going to do. May our words as Christians be trustworthy, not because we swear by things, not because we take oaths, but rather may our words be trustworthy because when we say yes, we mean it. And when we say no, we mean it. What we say, we act upon. We don't speak empty words that are meaningless, but when we say we're going to do something, we do it. Certainly, let's not be like Herod, who makes this stupid, foolish promise. And of course, what does Herodias' daughter ask for? She asks for John the Baptist's head on a platter. And it says that Herod is sad, and yet because he's taken an oath and because there's the audience of people at his birthday watching, he delivers what he's promised. And John the Baptist's head is brought out on a platter. He's been beheaded in prison. Herod's third sin, then, is the murder of John the Baptist. Now let's have a look at verse 1. That was a past event. The murder of John the Baptist was something that's happened in the past. But now in verse 1, Herod hears about Jesus' fame. He hears about the miracles. He hears about the teaching. He hears that this guy is doing amazing things. And you know what Herod thinks? He thinks, it's John. John's come back to get me. He's back from the dead. He says that, doesn't he? John the Baptist, he's been raised from the dead. That is why these miraculous powers are at work in him. Do you know guilt can destroy a person? Guilt makes Herod go and think crazily in this story. Guilt is a powerful force over our minds. And if you've done something in the past that you feel guilty about, it can play tricks with you. It can mess with your mind. It can make you go crazy. guilt can destroy a person. I wonder if there are people watching today who are struggling with guilt. In fact, maybe something I've even said in this sermon has triggered your guilt. Maybe you've committed adultery. Maybe you've had a divorce. Maybe you've spoken words that you've then not followed through. Maybe you've sworn by things in a bad way. And maybe something I've said during the sermon has triggered your guilt. Or maybe you're just struggling with guilt because of something you've said, done, or thought in the past. If that's you, if you're someone who is struggling with guilt this morning, there's only one way that I know to be free. There's only one way that I know to be free from guilt. And that way is faith in Jesus Christ. This is the story of the cross. Jesus takes upon himself the sin or the guilt of sin upon himself on the cross, and he dies, he's crucified, carrying our guilt. Jesus Christ died for the sins I was guilty of. He bore my punishment in order that I might be free from that guilt. This is the good news of Christianity. Jesus died for the guilt of the world. And that means that for everyone who places their faith in Jesus, in the eyes of God, they are guiltless. You know, I've done plenty of things wrong in my life. I can't deny that. I've done plenty of things wrong in my life. And yet, because of Jesus, in God's eyes, I am blameless. I am guiltless. I've never done anything. He sees me as this beloved, perfect son. He just pours out love. In God's eyes, I'm blameless, I'm guiltless because of the death of Christ on the cross. That is a powerful truth to transform your present reality. That is a powerful truth to speak over yourself when you feel guilty. When you have these moments of feeling guilty, you say, I'm not guilty. God says I'm not guilty. Jesus carried my guilt. He took my guilt to the grave. Before God, I'm guiltless and blameless. Therefore, I need not feel guilty because of what Jesus has done for me. If you're struggling with guilt, I only know one way to be free from guilt, and it's faith in Jesus Christ. If you're a non-Christian, put your faith in Jesus Christ today and know this removal of guilt that comes with that faith. And if you're a Christian, speak this truth over yourself. I am not guilty. I am blameless in the eyes of God because of what Christ has done for me on the cross. So guilt makes Herod go crazy. I just want to encourage you that if you're a Christian, you are guiltless before God in heaven. So what is Herod's most significant sin in this story? Is it his adultery? Is it his divorce? Is it his unlawful marriage? Is it his foolish oath? Or is it the murder of John the Baptist? What is Herod's most significant sin in this story? Why don't you make your pick now? Are you going for adultery, divorce? Are you going for an unlawful marriage? Are you going for a foolish oath? Or are you going for murder? Which is Herod's most significant sin? My argument is that it's none of those. None of those things are Herod's most significant sin in Matthew chapter 14. And let me explain why I think this by asking you another question. Why does Matthew include this story here and now in his account? Do you remember we've been studying chapter 13, and in chapter 13 Jesus tells a whole bunch of parables about the kingdom of heaven, and then at the end of chapter 13 Jesus goes to Nazareth, and there's questions about who Jesus is, and some people are going, is this not the carpenter's son? Is this not Mary's? Is Mary not his mother? Are these not his brothers and sisters? But there's no mention of John the Baptist. So why does Matthew choose to tell a story about John the Baptist at the beginning of chapter 14? And if you read on in chapter 14, the next thing that happens is that Jesus feeds 5,000 people, and then he walks on water doing amazing miracles. But there's no mention of John the Baptist or Herod. And so you're thinking, why has Matthew put this story in here at the beginning of chapter 14? It seems irrelevant to the story that comes before and the story of after. Why has Matthew put this here? Well, the connection between those stories is this question: who is Jesus? At the end of chapter 13, Jesus comes to Nazareth and the people are going, who is this guy? We thought this was Joseph's son. We thought this was Mary's son. We thought this was a brother of James, and so on and so forth. Who is this guy? Who is Jesus at the end of chapter 13? And then, at the beginning of chapter 14, a story about who Herod thinks Jesus is. And then, if you read through chapter 14 and you come to the end of the two miracles, the feeding of the 5,000 and the walking in the water, what do the disciples say? Truly, you are the Son of God. So the miracles that come after this demonstrate Jesus' true divine nature. He is the Son of God. He is the second person of the Trinity. He is God in human flesh walking on the earth. And if you continue reading through chapter 14 through to 15 and then into chapter 16, we come to this amazing moment where Peter says, Jesus, you are the Messiah. You are the Christ. This whole section of scripture is asking this question: who is Jesus? Is he the carpenter's son? Is he Mary's son? Is he John the Baptist, reincarnated, resurrected from the dead? Or is he the Son of God, the Messiah, the Christ, the Saviour to come into the world? And that's why this story is put in this part of Matthew's gospel. It's to aid this conversation about the identity of Jesus, who he truly is. So then, what is Herod's most significant sin? For me, it's not recognizing Jesus as the Son of God. It's thinking that Jesus is some reincarnation of John the Baptist, rather than seeing him as he truly is, the divine Son of God and Saviour of the world. Do you see how calling Jesus a resurrected John the Baptist is a slur and an insult and incorrect? If Jesus really is the Son of God, if you call him just the resurrected John the Baptist, then that's a much less important identity, isn't it? Why is this Herod's most significant sin? Because this is the truth of the gospel. Whoever believes in Jesus shall not perish, but shall have eternal life. In Christianity, forgiveness is for all who believe. In heaven, there will be adulterers. There will be divorcees. There will be people who've been married multiple times in heaven. There will be people who've made stupid promises and foolish oaths in heaven. There will be liars, people who say they were going to do one thing and didn't follow through on it and did another thing. And there will even be murderers in the kingdom of heaven. Why? Because the kingdom of heaven is not for perfect people who've never done anything wrong. No, the kingdom of heaven is for sinners who are forgiven by Jesus Christ, who are made perfect in the Holy Spirit's power. And this is why not recognizing Jesus for who he is Herod's most significant sin. Because Herod could have come to Christ, even after doing all of this, even after murdering John the Baptist, Herod could have come to Christ and received forgiveness if he had just recognized and believed in Jesus Christ. Herod's most significant sin was failing to see Jesus as the divine Son of God, who is the Saviour of the world. If you aren't a Christian watching this, thank you so much for watching. Thank you so much for enduring through this whole talk. If you're not a Christian, the most important question for you is this: who is Jesus? That's what Matthew's been talking to? That's the question Matthew's been addressing at the end of chapter 13 and through chapters 14, 15 and 16. Who is Jesus? And if you're not a Christian, your most significant sin will be rejecting Jesus' offer of forgiveness. Whatever your past, whatever you've done, whether you're an adulterer, whether you're someone who has an unlawful marriage or got an unlawful divorce, whether you're someone who lies all the time, even if you're a murderer, your most significant sin will be not accepting Jesus' offer of forgiveness. It will result in your eternal damnation. But if you do believe in Jesus, if you do recognize him for who he is, if you do accept his offer of forgiveness, in God's sight, you will be guiltless forever. You will enter into eternal life. You will receive divine joy and divine love. And although there'll still be trials and challenges here on earth, one day you'll enter into the new heavens and the new earth, and you will celebrate in paradise forever with Jesus, your Lord and Saviour. Your most significant sin will be rejecting Jesus' offer of forgiveness. Don't do it. Don't do it. Accept Jesus today. If you are a Christian, there's lots we've learnt from this passage. We need to pray for marriages. And if you're married, you need to prioritise your marriage. Prioritise your spouse. Love him or her faithfully. Love him or her with a sacrificial love that puts her or his interests before your own. If you're single, you need to be godly in the way you pursue romantic relationships, if that's the direction you want to go, accepting that Jesus is king and that his instructions for your life are always good and always loving and always best for you. We need to let our yes be yes. We need to let our no be no. We need to speak truthful words. Let our words be trustworthy and reliable. We need to be bold, perhaps, like John the Baptist, sharing hard truths with others. There's lots to learn from this passage. There's from this soap opera-like story. There's lots to draw out. But most importantly, if you're a Christian, remember and rejoice that Jesus is the Son of God who died on the cross to secure your salvation, to offer you forgiveness for all the things that you have done wrong. This is glorious. Even Herod could have entered into eternal life and received the forgiveness of Christ if he had trusted in him. And if you're a Christian, you have received from Jesus this glorious forgiveness that Jesus won for us upon the cross. It's an amazing truth, and that's what we should live in light of the cross for the rest of today, this week, and for the rest of our lives, celebrating the forgiveness that Christ has won for us. As we prioritize our marriage, let's remember we're forgiven by Jesus. As we pray for other marriages, let's remember we're forgiven by Jesus. As we seek romantic relationships in a godly way, let's remember that we're forgiven by Jesus. As we speak words that are true, let it in yeses be yeses and noes be noes, let's remember we're forgiven by Jesus. As we speak bold truth to others when we need to, let's remember that we are forgiven by Jesus. When we feel guilty, let's remember that we are forgiven by Jesus. For this is the message of Matthew chapter 14 and this soap opera story of Herod, John and Jesus. And on that note, let's pray. If you're not a Christian, but you want to receive this forgiveness I'm preaching about, join in this prayer by saying amen at the end. Amen means truly, truly, or means I agree. And so by saying amen, you're making this prayer your own. Let's pray together. Lord God, we confess that we have sinned, perhaps not in the same ways as Herod, but all of us have done things wrong, and we are in need of a saviour. We are in need of forgiveness. And therefore, we thank you for Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, taking our guilt upon himself. Thank you that he took our guilt to the grave. Thank you that he rose again victorious, so that all who trust in him are forgiven and have eternal life. Lord, we once again rejoice and celebrate the forgiveness we have in Christ. Lord, we pray for the marriages in our church. May they be strong, faithful, happy, loving marriages. We pray for single people in our church who are seeking romantic relationships. Lord, I pray that they would remain godly in the way they seek that relationship. Lord, we pray for those who are feeling guilty this morning. Lord, would you remind them of the forgiveness they have received in Christ. Lord, we pray for our words. May our words be trustworthy. May we not make foolish promises or oaths, but let our yes be yes and our no be no. And Lord, once again, we just remember the amazing forgiveness. Thank you, Jesus Christ, for being our perfect Saviour and redeeming us from guilt, sin, and death into wondrous, glorious life. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to finish our service by singing together, singing of the salvation that Jesus has won, singing Mighty to Save.
Everyone needs compassion, a love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of the Savior, the hope of nations. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Take me as you find me, all my fears and failures. Fill my life again. I give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender. Savior, He can move the mountain. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Shine light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Jesus, shine a light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move a mountain. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Savior, He can move the mountain. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Forever, author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.
Lord Jesus, You are a mighty Saviour. And as we finish our service, I pray You would pour out Your Holy Spirit upon everyone watching now. Equip us to live lives that are pleasing in Your sight, and remove all feelings of guilt, that we might walk in the forgiveness that Jesus has won for us upon the cross. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. There's a prayer meeting on Zoom at 11:15. I'd really, really love to see you there. If you're on our mailing list, you've already received the link. We're going to pray together. For everybody else, I hope you have a really wonderful week, and I'll see you very soon. Just a very quick reminder, actually. On Tuesday, our prayer meeting will be from 7 p.m. to 8 p.m. We're meeting outside in groups of six. We'll meet outside my house at 63 Hilson Drive, and we'll pray in groups of six on the in the field across the road from my house. You need to let me know that you're coming again, please, just so I can put you into groups of six and make sure we're observing the government guidelines. It was really great last week. It was a little chilly, but it was so good to actually pray in person with people rather than over Zoom. So I'd really encourage you to come along to that. Let me know by the end of Monday that you'd like to come. So we'll pray on Zoom now at 11:15, and then I'd love to see you on Tuesday to pray in person outside from 7 until 8 on Tuesday evening. God bless you, everybody, and see you very soon. Bye-bye.